lot of challenges out there. And I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. Training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. United States Marine Corps stands ready.
Welcome back to Red Beach here at Camp Pendleton, California. I'm Lieutenant Chris Harper. We're here with live coverage of Exercise Steel Knight. What we just witnessed was the Marines and Sailors of 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion and the Marines and Sailors of 3rd Battalion 1st Marines landed on Red Beach here at Camp Pendleton. Now they set up security and now they're moving on to their next objective. That means it's time for us to bring on our next guest. Colonel Scott Wirtz is an F-18 pilot and he's the Operations Officer G3 of 1st Marine Division. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Welcome.
Thanks.
Thank you for taking the time to join us today.
Absolutely.
Well, what we just saw, I was just speaking with Lieutenant Colonel Hauerhall, who is the commanding officer of 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion, and his Marines from Bravo Company just landed on the beach here, formed an amphibious landing, and are now establishing security around our position.
Absolutely.
This is the first phase of the final exercise of Steel Knight. Could you just tell me, give me and the folks at home an idea of the overall purpose and mission of Steel Knight?
Sure. Yeah, purpose basically is to get back to our core roots of combined arms, amphibious operations, the ability to move from sea to objectives, sea to shore. The Commandant has directed that the Marines get back to our core capabilities, core tasks. So General Bailey last June, directed that we do a fall exercise, a winter exercise, really. So we gave him several options, one of which was to do an exercise just on Camp Pendleton. One of which was to do one at 29 Palms. One course of action, or COA as we call it, was to do both at the same time. We did state that that'd be more difficult, involve more people, and more communications. But the general directed, yeah, that's what we want to do. So we had some real smart planners, led by Major Tom Kish, to get together all these different commands, multiple types of units. Units outside 1st Marine Division to include the Logistics Regiment, the Air Wing, the Navy, Assault Craft Unit 5, Assault Craft Unit 1, the Beachmasters, even the Air Force is participating in this exercise. And so we're going to do both at the same time. Today's D-Day.
All right, sir. Well, you mentioned there's, of course, a lot of units involved in this. Now, can you just give us perspective on what falls under 1st Marine Division for this exercise? Can you tell us the types of units that are involved in this?
Absolutely. For this exercise, we have a regimental landing team, which is RLT-1. The Marines who landed just now work directly for them. Colonel Baumgarten and RLT-1's commander. So he's got three battalions really working for him today. 1st Light Amphibian Reconnaissance. They're actually out on the LCACs right now. They'll be landing. 3-1, obviously, the infantry battalion that landed. 2-5, 2nd Battalion, 5th Marine Regiment. Actually works for 5th Marines, but they're going to work for RLT-1 today here. To include, we have some Singaporeans in those helicopters, 80 Singaporeans, so it's a coalition exercise. They're going to land in helicopters here at Camp Pendleton. Obviously, 1st Reconnaissance Battalion, so there's Recon Marines. They landed here and observed this shore already. And then at 29 Palms, we have 5th Marine Regiment. And then working with them, 3rd Marine Air Wing is both here and at 29 Palms. They've got an entire artillery regiment. Both one battalion here and several at 29 Palms. The Logistics Regiment has units all over here supporting us here and at 29 Palms. Obviously, we have some instructors as well from 29 Palms. They work for the Training and Education Command, and they are also supporting this event. So we have multiple types of units. As a matter of fact, what's called Anglico, the Air Naval Gunfire Liaison Company, they're working with the Singaporeans,
right.
So they're here as well. So we have multiple units that don't necessarily always work for 1st MARDIV, but are doing so in this exercise.
Sounds like a lot of planning and cross-coordination that has to go on there, sir. Could you just tell me a little bit about, interesting, you mentioned 1st Reconnaissance Battalion. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but there's a lot of planning and preparation that actually goes into, and a lot of work needs to be done before Marines actually hit the beach. Can you tell me what 1st Recon kind of does to set the conditions for 3rd Tracks to land like we just saw them do?
Yeah, absolutely. In this case, they're here. They're also at 29 Palms. So Recon has the ability to insert, clandestine insert, so the enemy doesn't know they're there, and that's obviously a goal. Here, they landed Saturday night. So a couple days ago, they actually landed in darkness, did a reconnaissance of this area. There's still reconnaissance Marines going to be airdropped into the hills to the east of us today. So those recon Marines, their job is to get in there. Nobody should be able to see them. And then they report back to us, in this case on the ships that we would be on, and tell us what the situation looks like.
So they're basically the eyes on the ground for the Marines who are about to come ashore.
Absolutely.
All right, sir.
Yeah.
Now, in addition to that, I understand they also provide like a forward observer capability for artillery and aircraft coming in to do close air support missions.
Absolutely.
And by forward observer, for the people at home, meaning basically the eyes and ears on the ground, to let the Marines and the artillery and the pilots such as yourself know what they're coming into. Can you talk about that a little bit as well, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. I've flown in direct support of multiple types of Marines talking. Reconnaissance Marines do a great job. Skilled Marines that can move ashore somewhere, they can move inland without being seen. Once they're ashore, they'll establish communications back to us on ships or to aircraft. If they see an enemy position, they'll call in the coordinates of that enemy, and we can airstrike, or ships' missiles can hit those targets.
All right, so let's bring it back to where we are. As you can see, take a look at the monitor here. Folks at home can see these are Marines from 3rd Battalion, 1st Marine Regiment. They came in on the AAVs from 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion.
Yeah.
Commanded by Lieutenant Colonel Howard Hall, who just spoke with us earlier. Right now, it looks like they set up some kind of perimeter security. Can you tell them what is the next step for these Marines today? What is the next thing they're going to be doing?
Next step, they move inland. We have notional enemy all over this base, so they would just need to continue to push inland. We have key terrain, key objectives that they'll seize. They have objectives such as road intersections. There's going to be other Marines push past them as well. You can hear the LCACs behind us. They'll be coming in. Bringing in 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion. Those Marines are going to push to the Pendleton airfield.
Right.
So we'll continue to just move inland, continue to fight the enemy, push him out of this base, and then ultimately push, theoretically, all the way inland to 29 Palms, although that's going on simultaneously.
Sure. And now we talk about a notional enemy that's going on here. Now, this is basically one big train exercise. So the Marines come in here, we'll be doing a bunch of different train exercises. Some will be conducting actual live fire against notional enemy, and others will be doing military operations and urban terrain training with blank fire. Is that correct?
That's exactly right. Yeah. Yes. So on this base, there are live fire ranges, and so the Marines will go to those. The Singaporeans that are involved, they'll be there as well. Additionally, we'll go into this base has several pretty nice facilities to allow training in buildings, basically urban terrain, a city, simulated city. So you can obviously those are difficult operations to do, so you need to train to that. So they have some ranges where you fire blanks, some ranges where you fire simmunitions or something like rubber bullets. Obviously they're not coming out that fast, but and then obviously live fire ranges where you're shooting targets with live rounds and artillery.
Sir, and as you already mentioned, we can hear the LCACs going behind us. They're kind of growling in the distance there with their big propellers. We actually have Marines from 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion. They're going to be rolling off those LCACs here shortly, supplied by Assault Craft Unit 5. Here in a little bit, I'd like to cut to a report from Sergeant Ned Johnson on the operations of LCACs, or landing craft air cushions. Apparently, we're not going to be able to cut to that report. Anyway, we'll continue our discussion on actual LCAC operations, sir. I've been on one of those a couple times. I know you probably have as well in your long Marine Corps career. Can you just give the folks a preview of what they're going to see today as the LCACs come on the beach? And as you know, they're going to be landing directly behind us here, so it's going to be pretty loud.
Yeah, exactly. We won't be able to talk while they're landing. They're big props and they're big engines. We can hear them from here. They're several miles offshore. They kick up a lot of dust, make a lot of noise. Assault Craft Unit 5 is based right here on Camp Pendleton, and they can lift vehicles ashore. So not just infantry, but they will do that. They will lift. They can lift almost anything,
and
really.
Speaking with Lieutenant Colonel Hall earlier, I understand they bring another set of amphibious capabilities to the table for the Marine Corps.
Absolutely.
And their lift capabilities are different from AAVs in that they can carry a little bit more crew and personnel and equipment. I understand they can carry a tank on that.
Right.
On the LCACs.
Absolutely.
What are we going to see them carrying today?
Well, they're supposed to be carrying first Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion, which is called the LAVs, Light Armored Vehicles. So it's a wheel vehicle with a gun on it. They're also going to be carrying ashore the 1st Marine Regimental Headquarters. Mm-hmm. They'll come ashore. Some of their artillery will likely be coming ashore here today as well. They can load all that onto those LCACs, simulating obviously coming from a ship and bring it ashore. So they can carry that heavier equipment. Obviously, these smaller AAV couldn't carry artillery, heavy weapons, couldn't carry a truck. So all those things got to come ashore with LCACs, with ACU-5.
I know I'm excited to see that, and I'm sure your viewers at home are as well. And right now, I'd like to go ahead and cut to a package by Sergeant Ned Johnson. He spent a little time over at Assault Craft Unit 5, talking to a craft master over there, and here is a package on LCAC capabilities. All right, and we're going to a package.
All right.
What is with...
Since the first amphibious assault landing in 1776, Marines have needed an expedient way to get from ship to shore and in the fight. Today, the sailors of Assault Craft Unit 5 use the landing craft air cushion, called an LCAC, to get Marines to shore. The LCAC is a hovercraft that can carry as much weight as a battle tank at a top speed of 50 knots or a little more than 40 miles per hour. These science fiction-like machines are more than 20 years old, but Chief Petty Officer Sean Turner tells us how the hovercraft helps Marines successfully complete an amphibious assault.
An LCU would actually try and go up to the beach, hits a sandbar, and now they're 50 yards from shore. We take a Marine from a nice dry well deck, put them all the way up onto a nice dry beach and have them happy and dry when they go to the fight.
Sailors of ACU-5 will be bringing the Marines of 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion ashore as a part of Exercise Steel Night 2013. Reporting from Camp Pendleton, California, I'm Sergeant Ned Johnson.
And welcome back to Exercise Steel Night live at Red Beach. I'm still chatting here with Colonel Wirtz from the Division G3 Operations. Right now we're talking about LCAC operations. You saw that package from Sergeant Ned Johnson, who's over with ACU-5, sir. Can you tell us what we're going to see coming off these LCACs today, the mission of 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion?
Sure. 1st LAR, Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion, has the LAV, Light Armored Vehicles. They're going to land, move inland. 3-1, or the infantry from 3-1, has established a perimeter here. 1st LAR, on this base, you have to actually drive under the highway because we'll go under Interstate 5. So in the real world, obviously, you would land and fan out. On this base, because we have a major interstate highway on it, everyone has to get on a small dirt road, go under the highway, and then you can spread back out and do your tactical operations.
Part of the exercise, but, we have to kind of
exactly.
Plan in the area. Where
yes. And obviously, the Marines do a good job of taking care of the environment here, and so that's part of our constraints. We operate inside of that. LAR is going to push ashore. They'll go through 3-1. They're going to press on to the Camp Pendleton airfield. In the real world, you'd want to seize an airfield so you can land follow-on forces. And that's exactly what they're going to do. They're going to go do their maneuvers around, seize that airfield, and they'll report back to us at 1st Marine Division that is accomplished. Once that's done, obviously we can land follow-on forces via helicopter, even aircraft could come from other nations, other bases to come in. So it's seizing that key objective of the airfield is LAR's job here today.
Okay. That sounds good, sir, and I know we're going to see that here shortly. Right now you see a Marine post of security on the beach. Anticipation of follow-on forces. So Marines from 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion and 3rd Battalion 1st Marines have secured the beachhead. And as you can see in our background, sir, if you take a look back with me, it appears LCACs from ACU-5 are actually coming on the beach here within the next minute or so. It's going to be very hard for us to actually have a conversation once that happens, so I want to give the viewers at home a little bit of idea of what they're going to see. They're going to be pulling up on the beach directly behind us, and as they come in, they're actually going to be floating on above the water. I understand they get as high as 4 feet off the water when they're hovering, because they are hovercraft.
Yeah, absolutely.
Once they come in, the actual cushion will deflate, and then there will be a ramp on the front of the ship that actually or craft rather, that will actually go down, and then the Marines and their light armored vehicles will roll out and move on to their objective. Does that sound about right, sir?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's the plan. Okay. Assuming everything works.
We'll see how that works. As you can see, this is a live shot here at Red Beach. We're looking at our monitor here, and I know you can see it at home. This is a LCAC landing craft air cushion hovercraft coming in from ACU-5. That's an assault craft unit 5. As you can see, these are Marines. So right now, those are Marines and sailors from our unit, along with media from the local area, filming these LCACs coming in. These things are moving pretty fast. They're going upwards of 30 knots in the water as they're coming into the beach. They'll slow down a little bit. I'm going to keep talking. Hopefully, people at home can still hear me over this. You see the first wave of LCACs about to hit the beach. We're going to switch to live shot, take a break from the commentary, and just let you watch the LCACs as they come in.
Bring a lot, because the LCAC brings the ability to bring heavier equipment ashore. The only other option, if you're not already on land somewhere, is Air Force heavy lift with an airfield somewhere. So, or a port, if we had a port. But if you don't have a port and you don't have an airfield, you've got to get your equipment ashore somehow, and that's exactly what they'll do for us.
This provides us a high degree of mobility from the sea. I know not as much as AAVs, but as if I recall correctly, these LCACs, like the ones featured from ACU-5, give us access to about 70% of the world's shoreline.
Absolutely.
And that's a big part, especially now that we're shifting our focus to our partnering with our Pacific allies.
Absolutely.
So while we're watching this LCAC preparatory to have LAVs roll off of it, we might get cut off here by the next one coming to land. You just talked about the partnering going on with our Pacific allies, the Singaporean Guard.
Yeah, absolutely. In this exercise, We frequently bring to Camp Pendleton and partner with 1st Marine Division. Singaporean forces come every year. We have partners with the Japanese and military partnerships with Australia and New Zealand as well. In this case, there was an exercise scheduled for the fall with Singaporeans, and we decided to just wrap it up into this exercise. So we have 80 infantry from Singapore, very skilled, smart, talented soldiers will be working directly with us, working with 2-5.
And sir, I hate to cut you off here. We'll get more on the Singaporean Guard here in a little bit. We have a couple of reports coming from Sergeant Alfred Lopez and Michael Cifuentes. But right now, it looks like our next group of LCACs are coming in, so we're going to take a turn to watch that because they're not going to be able to hear us anyway.
Okay, right, here they come. Sounds good. Yeah, that's the name of the Singaporean exercise. Okay. He's talking. All right. Check on the general real quick. Am I still tied in?
So good.
It looks like the second wave of LCACs has now landed on the shore. After all that noise, then we got a third wave coming in shortly after that, so I fully expect to be cut off again. And sir, we were just talking about Exercise Valley Mark. I know Second Battalion 5th Marines is out there working with the Singaporeans right now. Can you tell me a little bit about the kind of training they're doing?
Yeah, the Singaporeans are going to do some combined arms training. Obviously, they're getting a helicopter assault today. As they will be landing with helicopters.
All right, sir, we'll bring it back after this next LCAC comes in. I apologize if I'm here to watch.
A lot of challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready. lot of challenges out there. And I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready.
Marines who recently returned from a deployment to Afghanistan witnessed firsthand how important the role of building rapport with host nation security forces is. First Lieutenant Richard Marcantonio served as an advisor to the Afghan Army during a seven-month tour in northern Helmand province. He said the battalion's success with the Afghan forces stems from the individual relationships between the Marines and the Afghans.
Our relationships with foreign militaries is what keeps them strong, keeps us strong, and keeps us liked around the world and keeps us supported. And if they infringe upon that, especially with the local populace when they go and visit these ports or working with foreign military, it hurts us.
Advising not only helps the host nation with the means to provide security on their own, but frees Marines to delve into their own operations.
Just think of it as force multipliers, really, is you know, if you can employ a single Marine advisor team of 20 Marines and sailors, they can effectively advise a 500-man police force or even larger Afghan Army Kandak. You really freed resources to go elsewhere in the fight.
Although certain Marines serve the billet as advisor, building bonds and strengthening our military allies is a job for every Marine.
Everyone's going to interact. Every Marine in on a MU, every Marine who's going to be working for foreign militaries, that's what we do now, or it's what we've always done, and that's something we're going back to focus on now, is working with foreign militaries, because that's how we are strong and how we save ourselves from getting into large-scale warfare, is by building strong, helping to aid stronger foreign militaries. Because the stronger they are, the less aid that they're going to need if they go to war.
2nd Battalion, 5th Marines, are currently advising and training alongside Singaporean Guardsmen as part of Exercise Valiant Mark. Reporting from Camp Pendleton, California, I'm Marine Sergeant Michael Cifuentes.
And welcome back to Exercise Steel 9, live at Red Beach here at Camp Pendleton, California. I'm Lieutenant Chris Harper. Continuing with our coverage, LCACs are continuing to deliver Marines with 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion, as you can hear and see on the beach behind me. That means it's time to welcome our next guest to the webcast. He's an infantry officer who is deployed in support of Operation Iraqi Freedom and Operation Enduring Freedom, and likely a very proud Texas A&M Aggie fan after the Heisman Trophy ceremony this weekend. Lieutenant Colonel Brad Tippett is commanding officer of 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines. Good morning, sir. Welcome to the webcast.
Good morning. Thanks for having me out.
Thank you for hopping here after you. I know you just literally got out of the water.
Yep.
Can you go ahead and tell the folks at home a little bit about what your battalion is doing today?
Yep. 3-1's a part of battalion landing team for this exercise. We were the ones conducting the initial amphibious assault, the AAVs, the amphibious assault vehicles come across. And our mission initially in this part of this exercise is to secure that initial lodgment to allow the introduction of follow-on forces, the first of which is seeing out from behind us on the LCAC.
We'll just pause for a second so while the LCACs go by here because they can't really hear what's going on. Alright, sir, looks like we're back up here. The second to last LCAC has landed. We were talking about what your battalion was doing. Can you tell the folks at home a little bit about what you were doing during this initial amphibious landing, where you were on the tracks out there?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if you could tell from the broadcast, and I don't know what you guys were covering, but you know, we came across in four waves. The initial waves, the first three were my line companies, India, Kilo, and Lima. Those guys securing the initial beachhead. I was conducting command and control in conjunction with the amphibious assault company commander of those forces coming ashore. And the piece that we're working through is that piece coming across and the communication back to what we're simulating, our shipboard communications, and tracking that progress ashore and then communicating not only our movement, but also the fire support coordination that continues to go on as we're coming ashore.
And after speaking with Lieutenant Colonel Hall of the command officer of Third Tracks, he explained to me and the viewers at home that in fact, as the ground force commander, you are charged with amphibious landing and he's there in support of you.
Yeah, that's right. You know, we had Captain John Kim supporting us from Bravo Company, Third Tracks. Those guys, you know, they provide us that support, but fall in as part of the team, but provide us that expertise, you know, to do those types of things. You know, while we're certainly more than passengers out there in the water, we'd certainly default to them, not only in the navigation, the other pieces.
All right, sir. Well, we're going to stop discussion briefly. We're going to actually cut to a report. Report by Sergeant Alfred Lopez discussing the exercise guiding mark running concurrently with exercise steel knife. Report the 2nd Battalion 5th Marines doing with the 3rd Singaporean Guard.
Training with guardsmen of 3rd Battalion Singapore Guards during exercise battle.
All right, let's go.
Partner force blasted through 3 days of live fire maneuver exercises and a heavy weapons familiarization range.
We're doing a variety of basic infantry skills, starting out with squad attacks and then moving on to platoon attacks. And then today we did a live fire of some of our heavy machine guns because they don't have the opportunity to shoot in Singapore. So it's been basic, you know, basic infantry skills, fire and movement, fire and maneuver.
Singaporean guardsmen gained first-hand knowledge of employing the Marine Corps' Mark 19 automatic grenade launcher and M2 50 caliber machine gun. With guidance from Fox Company's Marines, the guardsmen were able to improve their basic fire and maneuver skills by taking advantage of Camp Pendleton's immense training grounds.
We do conduct live firing, so by and large it's very similar, just that the space here allows us to conduct a more complex maneuver, which gives soldiers more confidence in executing their drills.
Valiant Mark's final exercise, which will coincide with Exercise Steel Knight, will test the skills practiced today by the Marines and Guardsmen, as well as their professional relationship. Reporting from Camp Pendleton, California, I'm Sergeant Alfred Lopez.
And welcome back to our live webcast of Exercise Steel Knight here on Red Beach at Camp Pendleton, California. You saw the last of the landing craft air cushions land on the shoreline behind me. We also just saw a report from Sergeant Alfred Lopez on Exercise Valiant Mark being conducted with 2nd Battalion 5th Marines and the 3rd Singaporean Guard. I'd like to get back to our discussion with Lieutenant Colonel Brad Tippett here, talking about partnering with our Pacific allies. Sir, I understand that your unit is going to be preparing for to go on a UDP or a unit deployment program over to Okinawa in the fall.
Yeah, that's correct. You know, as you know, you know, the Marine Corps kind of took a pause from deploying infantry battalions in support of the UDP program a few years back so that we could meet the requirements for OIF and OEF. We've resumed that, and 1st Marine Division
will send its first infantry battalion back into that rotation with 3-1 in the fall of 2013.
And what were the kind of things that you expect to be doing while you're on this deployment with your battalion as far as partnering with your Pacific allies?
Yeah, I think, two-fold mission. You know, the partnering comes for those things that we're expecting to do, some bilateral development with countries that are out there, training with small units and also training their staffs and their command and control capabilities to be able to develop those skills. But it's also an opportunity for us to be able to prepare for those contingencies and crises, which we have plans in place for. So if those things are required, we've honed those skills not only as the Marine Corps, but with our partners that we're going to fight alongside in the event of those crises or contingencies.
And so this seems like a natural progression. I mean, we've always conducted partner training with our allies, and we certainly have stepped that up a lot in Afghanistan and in support of Operation Enduring Freedom over the last few years. We saw a report from Sergeant Michael Cifuentes covering some of the embedded police mentor teams down in Khanishin District in Helmand Province. And do you think this is just a natural progression for the Marine Corps to continue partner and build these relationships with our allies in the Pacific?
Yeah, I think it's something that is a continuation of what we've been doing for about 237 years, you know, to tell you the truth. I mean, you know, our history is ripe with examples of Marines at small unit levels partnering with other nations and solving their problem, helping them solve their problems and building those relationships as a result of that. So while we saw some real pointed examples of that in Afghanistan and in Iraq with the Afghans and the Iraqis, what we're going to continue to see, I think, is just those things which, you know, the junior leaders in the Marine Corps are just good at. They do those things well. They have the skill set to be able to train other folks and to be able to learn from them as well. And for whatever it is, that special thing that Marines have, they get along well with those folks. So it's a good thing.
That's good. Great insight on that, sir. Now, if you can look at the monitor over here, we're going to turn the discussion back to the light armored vehicles that are currently rolling by our position here. Describe for the folks at home what exactly is going on and really at what point your battalion comes into the interaction with 1st Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion.
Okay.
Here.
Yeah, in the layout of this exercise right now, what's going on now is this LAV company is in support of 1st Marine Division. We have established a lodgment to allow their introduction so that they can go to the 1st Division objective and secure that objective. But they can't do that on their own. As you know, those LCACs can't come ashore without some level of security. So off camera are the Marines of 3-1 providing that security for these Marines from Charlie Company, 1st LAR, to be able to consolidate their forces and then move out in just a great capability with not only a great deal of speed and maneuverability, but also firepower to get quickly to that 1st Division objective.
Now, it looks like there's still good Marines that are, of course, posted security on the beach from your battalion and from 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion. Now, they're pressed farther up, and I understand they're going to be conducting something called a forward passage of lines. Can you explain what that is for our viewers?
Yeah, that's correct. You know, as LAR kind of comes into our fold, you know, if you think of kind of a half circle that we've got formed around with the beach at our back right now, LAR will be in that fold. But to get them out, it requires a pretty good amount of coordination so that we ensure not only that that the folks who are on our defensive perimeter know they're coming, but in turn that we transition fire support to them when they get outside of that. And then once eventually they'll exit our battle space and we'll control their own fires and their own maneuver, et cetera. But they effectively have to come through our lines into our battle space forward of us. So there's a lot of deconfliction to make sure that what they do is not only safe, but we provide them support as the battle space owner while they're passing.
All right, sir. Now, your unit as the battalion landing team 3-1, you kicked off this exercise the first day of D-Day of exercise Steel Knight 2013. What we're seeing now is we're getting towards the end of the first phase of the exercise here. Now that you've established security on the beach, you've pressed a little bit forward and established more perimeter security with 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion, are preparing to conduct a forward passage of lines, which I know you'll be doing here shortly,
right,
as soon as you hop off the air with me. What's next for your battalion as far as this exercise goes? What's your objective for the rest of the week here?
Yeah, we've got a series of objectives in support of maintaining two big pieces, the ability for 1st Marine Division to be able to maintain security and operation of the airfield, which in this exercise is a key objective. It'll allow the introduction of a whole lot more follow-on forces via strategic lift and those types of things in this scenario. But we're also providing conducting offensive operations to defeat the enemy and secure the ability for Regimental Combat Team 5 to proceed on inland to follow on objectives hundreds of miles inland. So, you know, we're going to conduct offensive operations to do those pieces so that really enabling two different types of forces. One, those that are going to secure the airfield, and two, those that are going to go on further inland.
And that's the securing the airfield will be first Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion.
Correct.
And then the Regimental Combat Team 5 will be pressing forward with their own three infantry battalions up there, artillery and close air support, as well at the Marine Corps Air Ground Combat Center in 29 Palms.
That's right, yep.
Okay. That's what's going on inland, but I'd like to know, sir, more specific, what kind of training events will your battalion be doing? I know we're obviously fighting a notional enemy this week.
Right.
But what types of things are you doing? I understand there'll be live fire training on several of the many ranges on Camp Pendleton. But what other kind of training will they be conducting?
As a part of the scenario, kind of what we're getting the opportunity to do is integrate not only the scenario in the training we're doing, what you see with the amphibious assault vehicles, which is a special skill set to be able to develop, but we're also do dismounted operations, both offensive, attacks on fortified positions, as well as movement to contact, and then transition to defensive operations in a dismounted setting. From there, what we've had the opportunity to do and through some pretty good coordination with the division and the folks here at Camp Pendleton, to be able to integrate those defensive positions into live fire operations in a kind of a seamless transition. So my Marines will come out of their defensive positions, patrol into a live fire attack, and then transition back into the defensive position. Folks in right now on squad reinforced level attacks, you know, that basic building block for the infantry battalion, get based off where we were at in our progression, our development cycle. And then I've also got my combined anti-armor teams doing training and my scout sniper platoon in support of those exercises, the non-live fire portion, and then doing live fire precision shooting skills as we go along.
And sir, you said that we're in the kind of squad reinforced phase right now, doing live fire training, doing defense positions corporate with live fire training, certainly military operations and urban terrain training with the various mount towns that we have across Camp Pendleton. What is this leading to? What progress? Where is this progress going to go as you prepare for your UDP in the fall?
Yeah, you know, where we're at right now, we've got a great opportunity to have some depth, some time to be able to prepare for the next deployment, which is a great thing. So we're taking those opportunities to train to those basic skill sets. But as we come back off of, you know, this battalion did a deployment to Afghanistan in 2010, then they did the MU, having recently deployed in June of this year, we'll go to UDP. But the reality, some of those skill sets that we've had down pretty well about 10 years ago have atrophied. So we're taking the time from the ground level, from the fire team level, from the squad level, and on up to integrate those high-end offensive and defensive skills that have kind of really atrophied a little bit. We'll start with those small unit levels and then work our way up. We're scheduled to participate in the integrated training exercise up to 29 Palms. That'll be in May this year, and then follow on with a trip up to the Mountain Warfare Training Center in Bridgeport. And as we progress through there, what we'll see there at ITX is we'll have moved from squad level tactics now in those reinforced positions all the way up to company and battalion level operations by May of next year, and then kind of finalize that stuff in June of this year.
Well, I'm sure we'll be, if not made into my Marines, we'll be providing coverage for you over there at the
Hopefully.
ITX. I don't know if I'm cool enough to send anybody up to Bridgeport Mountain Warfare training with you up there.
It's the summertime. You'll be good.
Yeah, okay. Well, we'll see. I don't know, sir. I think it might still be cold for some reason. Miserable either way. But I'll keep that in mind. What I would like to talk about is, you know, some of the training that you think you would like to do with while you're on UDP, when you're working with these specific allies. What kind of stuff do you see yourself actually working with them on? Like, what kind of training environment? Considering, you know, they're on the other side of the world, it's much different than our, you know, our region here.
Right. I think it offers a couple great opportunities. One, the geography and the topography that we find in some of those countries is a tremendous opportunity for our Marines to train in. You know, the jungle warfare settings that are prevalent in a lot of the Pacific nations, it's just something we don't get the opportunity to do here. We have some of those training centers that we're working on improving there on Okinawa, but certainly those exist in our partner nations as well. But some of the other pieces that are unique is the ability for us to be able to integrate our amphibious skill sets, you know, in everywhere we go, because every one of those countries, amphibious operations are a ripe training ground. They're a ripe training ground for those, because obviously they're surrounded by water.
And we obviously have a ripe training ground here as well, sir, as you can see. taking out our LCACs, pulling a 180 and heading back out to shore. It's causing a lot of noise, a lot of blowback of water, wind, and sand coming back on our Marines on the beach here. I don't know if you can still hear the audio, but I'm going to try to describe the scene for you. These hovercraft actually get lifted up to almost a 180 without moving back to the crew and head right back out. I mean, I'm in their corner on the beach. It's pretty incredible capability.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, that's one of the best things the Navy's been able to do over a period of time is that integration with us to be able to make those ship-to-shore movements in a rapid fashion. That type of technology is good, but we've got to continue to integrate that stuff with the Navy so that those skills don't atrophy as well.
And we're going to take a quick pause here as the LCACs turn around to head back out to sea. We're going to continue our coverage live at Steel Night here in a few minutes.
A lot of challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready. A lot of challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready.
Welcome back to Red Beach here at Camp Pendleton, California. Again, I'm Lieutenant Chris Harper. I'm sitting here with Lieutenant Colonel Brad Tippett, Commanding Officer of 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines, better known as Battalion Landing Team 3-1, today on Red Beach. As you can hear it in the background behind me here, still LCACs getting ready to move back out into the water. Right now I'd like to continue my discussion with Lieutenant Colonel Tippett, talking about, you know, really the changes in the Marine Corps' focus coming off of, as we draw down from Operation Enduring Freedom in Afghanistan. We really shifted our focus into the security force assistant model there in Afghanistan, sir, mentoring the Afghan police, mentoring the Army, helping them with mentoring their government as well,
right?
And now we're shifting to back to this amphibious roots is a key word you hear a lot,
right?
Around the Marine Corps. And a lot of these Marines, I know myself and you as well, sir, if I may speak for you, you're used to ground pound in the desert, and we haven't been on in the water for a while, so this must be a refreshing experience for you.
Yeah, it's good for me, and it's good for the Marines. You know, the great thing about the Marines at 3-1 right now, having gotten back off the 11th Marine Expeditionary Unit back in June, there, a lot of those guys are not as novice as some folks, even like myself, who, you know, hadn't spent time on a boat since 1998. You know, so
it is a great experience, you know, to be able to go back and do these things. You know, the amphibious aspect is one aspect of our expeditionary capabilities. You know, it's a way to get there. It's a mobile capability, and it's a ready capability. So I think it's something we got to continue to work and hone, pull back on some of those things that we used to be good at in the past. Integrate some of the latest technologies so we can stay relevant in this type of operation.
It looks like we're doing pretty good getting up on the right foot here, getting back to those amphibious roots with this exercise. Our viewers at home here can see LCAC heading back out to sea. It's really an impressive display what these machines can do. And you know, even more importantly, what the sailors on there piloting these machines are capable of. Looks like we've dropped off the last of the first Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion Marines and sailors. As you can see right now, an LCAC is literally lifting up and hovering off the ground, pulling a 180, and will be speeding out to sea via its propellers on the back of the craft. We're going to pause as you can't hear anything anyway now. Alright, looks like the second to last LCAC is heading back out to sea, and you hear that roar behind me. The last one is about to lift off from the shore. Let's go to that. Ladies and gentlemen, on your screen right now, you see the final LCAC moving back out to shore, going back out to that notional amphibious shipping. Now you're seeing a view of an AAV with 3rd Assault Amphibian Battalion right there. See the last LCAC heading back out to shore. The LCACs are, of course, supplied by our Navy brethren over there at Assault Craft Unit 5. And, sir, just to kind of wrap this up for folks, can you give me a little bit of perspective on the overall exercise Steel Knight and what that means, not only to you and as you command 3-1 for the near future, but kind of the Marine Corps overall and our shift to focus specific?
Yeah, I think it's kind of that hallmark, if you will, of a shift from, you know, what we've been doing in support of counterinsurgency operations for really the past decade plus, to, you know, getting our Marines both mentally and physically shifted in their capabilities back to be able to support operations in the Pacific, but as well as to be that global crisis response force. You know, those type of skills are not gained easily. But the one thing that we have, you know, at our advantage is those junior leaders who are a part of 3-1 and a part of the Marine Corps at large. Regardless of whether it's old or whether it's new, those guys are the common denominator, and they'll be the ones who will carry the day and generate success.
What's really incredible to me, and hopefully the people at home can get a good perspective on exactly how much work goes into this. As we saw amphibious vehicles coming in, your own battalion of infantrymen are coming off the shore, sir. Right now, you can hear it. We've got support and assault aircraft flying overhead. So this is really an effort by all elements of the Marine Air Ground Task Force.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you know, the MAGTAF is a unique capability that, you know, combines those aspects, combines the aviation, combines the air, combines the aviation, the ground, the logistics, all those pieces into kind of one synthesized whole, and delivers it in the right size package that's required for whatever mission it may be. If it's large scale operations, we can do that with a MEF. If it's small scale, we can do that with a MEU or special MAGTAF. But those principles all apply, and it's unique to what the Marine Corps can deliver.
Well, as you look forward to with your battalion, is there anything that you'd like you know, your Marines and sailors to keep in mind, or anything you'd like to say to them, and speaking to their families now?
Yeah, I'm hopeful that not a lot of my Marines are watching this right now. Because we've had some issues associated with bringing out personal devices out of the field. However, hopefully more than a couple of families, both immediate and extended, current and past, and 3-1 are getting a chance to watch this based off of some of the information we put out. And I think I'd just like to reemphasize first that, you know, this is what we do, and this is what we train to do, and the Marines are good at this. You know, we can get this down, but really, you know, that platform.
grounded in our families. And, you know, I've said it every time I get an opportunity to talk to my families. You know, they really do provide that platform from which we fight from, and I'm appreciative for it. So to you all who may be out there listening, thanks from Bomber 6.
All right, sir. Well, I think that's, you know, taking up enough of your time today. I want to thank you for your expertise, your knowledge, and the time that you shared with us today. And if there's anything else you'd like to add on this?
No, thanks for having me out.
All right, sir.
All right, I'm going to get back to it.
All right.
All right, and as we're waiting, ladies and gentlemen, we're waiting here for the final LCAC to exit over to the beach. Looks like ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with more coverage from Exercise Steel Night here at Red Beach for Camp Pendleton, California.
Challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready. Challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. The United States Marine Corps stands ready. Challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps. United States Marine Corps stands ready. A lot of challenges out there, and I think as a Marine Corps, we need to be ready to respond to all those challenges. We're training now for contingencies or whatever may confront this nation in the future. When you are a nation that survives off the global commons, then you need a force like the United States Marine Corps.
When the Marines need to take a beach, the amphibious assault vehicle gets them there. Second Lieutenant Connor Murphy commands a platoon of AAVs. He understands the capabilities it brings to the fight.
So we can establish a foothold on the beach. Each AAV has a 50 caliber machine gun and a Mark 19 fully automatic grenade launcher. It allows us to create a great deal of suppression on the enemy, create a good standoff distance, and allow the infantry to assault through the objective on the beach.
Introduced in the 1970s, the AAV remains the key component of the Corps' amphibious strategy. It can move more than 20 Marines and their gear. It has several advantages over other troop transports, like helicopters and hovercrafts.
We're able to splash in less than favorable conditions. With air assets, they're usually looking at a very narrow scope for the kind of weather that they can launch in. So that allows commanders greater flexibility in planning an amphibious operation.
After landing on the beach, the vehicle can travel up to 200 miles without refueling, giving the infantry the firepower and the mobility they need to succeed in combat. Reporting from Camp Pendleton, California, I'm Marine Sergeant Jacob Harlan.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exercise Steel Night 2013. Still Lieutenant Harper reporting to you live from Red Beach here at Camp Pendleton, California. We're getting ready to wrap things up here at Red Beach. And I just want to remind you that Steel Night is a combined arms exercise featuring Marines and sailors from all elements of the Marine Air Ground Task Force, or MAGTAF. This amphibious landing that you saw today was the kickstarted Exercise Steel Night. We'll be continuing training events throughout the rest of the week here at Camp Pendleton and aboard the Marine Corps Air Ground Combat Center in 29 Palms, California. For more information on Exercise Steel Night and reports from our combat correspondents, be sure to check out the 1st Marine Division Facebook page at www.facebook.com/1st Marine Division. We'd also like to extend a special thank you to our friends at Encompass Digital Media and Defense Video and Imagery Distribution System, or DVIDS, for hosting this webcast. You can find video and imagery from across the Department of Defense at www.dividshub.net. Now from Camp Pendleton, California, I'm Lieutenant Chris Harper again with 1st Marine Division Public Affairs. Thank you for tuning this morning, and hopefully we'll see you again soon.